Welcome to Café DC. I'm Faiz Rahman. Back in 2007, January 2007, we did a report on Congressman Keith Ellison, the first Muslim American to be elected to the US Congress. And it was quite a big deal, and also because Representative Ellison chose to take the oath of his office on a Quran, on a copy of the Holy Quran. And one more interesting fact about this whole, story, was that he decided to use an old copy of the Quran, which was bought and kept and probably read by Thomas Jefferson, America's third president and also the author of the Declaration of Independence. Lo and behold, a few years later, I saw a book, actually first the announcement of a book, Thomas Jefferson's Quran. A very notable professor at University of Texas in Austin, Professor Denise Spellberg, decided to write a book on this very interesting topic. May not be very interesting to the local populace, general American public, but extremely interesting and intriguing for the Muslim world and the Muslims also in living in the countries where they're not in majority. Luckily, we got hold of Professor or Dr. Spellberg. She's with us today for this episode of Café DC. Unfortunately, she couldn't make it to the studio because she lives a few thousand miles away from Washington, D.C. in Austin, Texas. So she's here with us on Skype. Skype looks good. The quality of picture looks good. Sounds is very good. Hopefully, you'll enjoy this interview. Professor Spellberg, thank you very much for joining us.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
Well, let's go directly into the nitty-gritty of this book. Why did you decide to write this book in the first place?
It was a project that began accidentally for me. I'm a professor of early Islamic history, religion and history, and I found some evidence that Americans during the Revolutionary War had watched a play performed ostensibly about the Prophet, and this, I had no idea that in the 18th century Americans knew anything about Islam, and so I decided slowly to investigate not only what they knew, but how they knew it. And that's how I came across information about the fact that Thomas Jefferson had owned a Quran.
So you actually knew it when I think the Congressman Keith Ellison decided to take the private oath of his office on this copy, right?
You know, I knew that he owned a Quran. I didn't know that it had survived.
I see.
Because he bought the Quran in 1765, which is 11 years before he wrote the Declaration of Independence.
Right.
And 5 years later, there was a fire at one of his houses, and he claimed that all his books were lost.
His mother's house, actually, right?
That's right. And in fact, it's possible that he bought the Quran twice. We can't prove it, but if he lost the Quran in that fire, then how did it end up in the Library of Congress? He donated all his books to become the National Library. So somehow it survived.
Yes. Professor, I mean, this is an excellent account of actually not just Thomas Jefferson's library, his collection of the books, and also what went through his mind when he was about to write that wonderful piece of, what you call history. Actually, now it's one of the most famous documents in the world, the Declaration of Independence. This book, Thomas Jefferson's Quran, first of all, it also deals with the history of Muslims in this country. Of course, there's a lot about Jefferson himself, his thought process. But before, actually, let me give you a little bit of background. What happened when we were trying to do a story on Keith Ellison, Congressman Keith Ellison, as the first Muslim member of Congress? The idea, or probably most people thought that, you know, the reason he's trying to take oath, the private oath of his office on the Jefferson's Quran, was because somehow Jefferson was also influenced by the Quranic teachings. And that was the perception which was created around the world, especially in the Muslim world, that, you know, and also that was one of the reasons that when President Obama spoke in Cairo, he also mentioned by name this congressman, and also the fact that he took the oath of his office on Jefferson's Quran. So, but going through this book, you hardly see that as a fact. You know that you know a lot of times you come out as not being convinced, as if Jefferson actually used some of the ideas from the Quran in the Declaration of Independence, or you know, in other documents that he wrote later on. Would that be something to say that yes, it's closer to the fact?
You know, I was looking for evidence that the Quran had influenced him. He took a lot of notes in the period just after he bought the Quran, but he has no notes about the Quran. And I have to say I was disappointed, because it's hard to know what he thought about the Quran at this early stage. When he bought it, he was a student of law. So we assume that because this translation describes the prophet as the lawgiver of the Arabians, that that phrase would have struck him and invited him to read the Quran. But we don't have evidence of how he was thinking about it. We do have evidence, however, that he was looking for legal precedents at the same time, and that he came across one from early British history from the 17th century that he wrote down, in which there is a ruling that describes Turks, meaning Muslims in at this time, as not perpetual enemies, as people like ourselves, the author of this statement read. And Jefferson wrote down that in his private notes in this period. And by 1776, he was looking at the issue of rights for Muslims. So even though
by 1776,
yes, okay. By 1776,
the year that he wrote the Declaration, yeah.
A few months later, he went back to Virginia to write laws there, because this was a newly independent state. And he has a note from his hero, John Locke, the English philosopher, that says, neither pagan nor Mohammedan, meaning Muslim, nor Jew ought to be excluded from the rights of the Commonwealth because of his religion. And that's a pretty startling statement for the 17th century. But in the 18th century, the fact that he took this note indicates that he was considering the furthest reaches of toleration, but also civil rights, not just for non-Protestants, but including Muslims in that statement. So he was thinking about what kind of future society we would have in the United States, and he was explicitly thinking about Muslims.
One of the contradictions that I noticed here was that, you know, on the one hand, yes, of course, he seemed to have been influenced by John Locke's thoughts, you know, liberal thoughts on religion and society.
Right.
But at the same time, and you mentioned it very well, quite a few places in your book, Voltaire's thoughts, I mean, you know, anti-Muslim thoughts. So he all, and he seems to have repeated those thoughts, you know, in during his conversations with different people, and in some places, like, you know, even in Congress. So what do you make of that contradiction?
Well, you know, Jefferson was a consummate politician. So on the one hand, he used sentiments that he took directly from Voltaire without really any examination. And the claim that Voltaire made was that Islam was a science, was a religion rather, that repressed science. And we know that's not true. Even Voltaire knew that was not true, because a few pages later in the same text in which he says that, he talks about Islamic contributions to science and chemistry and other important breakthroughs that helped Europe, particularly in the Renaissance. But Jefferson just stuck with that idea. And one of the reasons he did it was because he was trying to use Islam as an example of how religion and government were fused together. And this was part of a longer arc of
which,
British,
in his opinion, wasn't a good idea, right?
Well, he was trying to use Islam to move people to separate religion and government in Virginia. And he also, he was antagonistic in those notes in Virginia, but also he criticized Catholicism for the same reason. And this was a standard Protestant thing to do. You know, it wasn't very inventive. But of course, at the same time, as he's trying to separate religion from the state, he is thinking about who might be citizens. And so although he seems to have a position on Islam early on that's negative, but not original, and not reversed by reading the Quran, he's still thinking in very broad terms about a religious pluralism for his state and for his country. And we know this because 5 years before he died, he said that his bill for religious freedom, the one of the three things he was most proud of, along with the Declaration of Independence, is that he thought it should include Muslims and Hindus and basically everyone. And he said this explicitly. You know, one of the contradictions of Jefferson's ideas about rights, too, is that he was a slave owner. Exactly. And he never seems to have recognized that among the slaves transported against their will to the United States from West Africa were probably Muslims.
And I think he never
noticed Islam on his Virginia plantations. But we know, for example, that George Washington, who was also living in Virginia, had at least two Muslim slaves. We know this from their names. So on the one hand, he's
what
preaching
were those
about
names,
rights.
If you can, please, just for our audience?
Sure. Interestingly enough, again, you know, if we look through Jefferson's list of slaves, there are no names that are overtly Muslim. Whereas for George Washington, we have two women's names, and they're written out in 1774 as Fatimer, F-A-T-I-M-E-R, and Little Fatimer, of course, named after the prophet's daughter. So this is a tragic and heartbreaking contradiction in all of this lofty theorizing about a future, but a future that would include Muslims who would presumably be from abroad and be free, right? So race obscured his ability to really implement his most favorite law in practice. It could never include Muslim slaves because he was not going to abolish slavery. He never reached that position.
Interesting. One more contradiction that I noticed, of course, and you answered already that, you know, he was a politician, a pragmatist politician at that. He adopted his views, actually Voltaire's views on Islam and Muslims. But Voltaire at the same time was a rabid anti-Semite as well. I mean, you know,
yes.
But he doesn't seem to have espoused those views about the Jewish population of that time. So what was, why, so he actually picked and chose, right?
Right, Jefferson was selective. I mean, at the same time he's adopting, just for the sake of argument really, this position that Islam represses free inquiry, and he was all about freedom of thought, right? So he wanted a kind of straw man to fight against. I think that's the only reason he chose that example for Islam. But at the same time, he's making notes about Jews being advantageous to the new state of Virginia. And so, no, I mean, he didn't follow Voltaire.
And it was because maybe one of the reasons was because they did not really come in contact with the Muslims during those times. The only Muslims which were happened to be in the United States, they were just slaves.
But during his life, Jefferson would actually meet two Muslim ambassadors, and negotiate with them directly. Once in London with an ambassador from Tripoli in 1786, and once he would entertain as president in 1805 the first Muslim ambassador to the United States.
Melly
was his name,
yes,
right?
Yes.
And
quite,
in fact,
he was quite a colorful character, I read.
He was very colorful. People were completely fascinated by his visit. Mm-hmm. He was treated with great distinction. A special suite in a hotel was bought for him. And he stayed for almost half a year, really.
So the president's account that the first iftar dinner was actually during those times for this ambassador, Melly Melly, by Jefferson. I mean, President Obama made this...
Yes.
You know, so was it?
Yes.
Was
well, I mean, of course, Jefferson, to be honestly accurate about this, Jefferson knew enough about Islam to move the state dinner he had planned for 3:30 to sunset. Mm-hmm. But to call it an iftar is kind of a stretch, right? So on the one hand, he's going to accommodate the Muslim ambassador and respect his religious freedom. And on the other hand, he's not going to make it a fully Islamic celebration of fast breaking. So he was ahead of his time in this, it seems to me, practically, too.
But,
and this is in the middle of his still trying to negotiate a final treaty with Tripoli. And as I say in the book, what's interesting is that by this point, Jefferson seems to have understood enough about Islam, perhaps from his Quran, to write to the rulers of Tripoli and Tunis and to invoke a belief in a shared God. When he was signing off on these letters, he wrote, "May God have you in his holy keeping." And that presumes, of course, that both men worship the same God. That's another unusual aspect of his understanding of Islam, which seems to have evolved over his lifetime, I have to say.
Well, this is quite an interesting to, I mean, if you look at the evolution of this country, the United States of America, you know, from this event where, you know, just having a copy of the Quran was considered like, you know, a big deal, to the idea of basically having iftar dinners, not at, just at the White House, but also at all, you know, all the major departments here, Department of State, Pentagon, you know, so all these departments, the White House, Congress, they, you know, they hold these iftars every year, they hold Eid dinners, and Muslims are now in, you know, in quite a big number, as you quote in your book, anywhere from 3 million to 8 million people who
yes.
profess this faith. One more interesting observation that I saw in your book was that Thomas Jefferson was actually the first president who was accused of being a Muslim.
How'd that happen? Well, you know, there is a long and unfortunate history of Christians calling each other or defaming each other by reference to Islam, right? The United States didn't invent this in the 20th or 21st century rhetoric of hatred toward Muslims. Instead, what we see is that Europeans regularly invoked Islam to disparage each other, either Protestants disparaging each other for their beliefs or between Protestants and Catholics. So in 1791, for example, Jefferson is thought to have written something about John Adams that accused him of supporting monarchy and aristocracy. And John Adams' son took issue with that and under a pseudonym wrote in a Boston newspaper that Jefferson was like, he compared him to the Arabian prophet. We know who that is. And he said that, in fact, this was a moment where he compared Jefferson also to, he mentioned the Islam of democracy and how Jefferson's followers, although Jefferson isn't named, but it's clearly about him, that his followers raised the swords of the Islam of democracy, right? So the image here is of the prophet, a long-held one that's negative for John Quincy Adams and also John Adams to some degree, that the prophet is militant and spread the faith by the sword. And so the association with Jefferson is that he's just like Muhammad, which was sort of a slur at the time.
So
right?
Obama is not the only president who's been accused of, you know,
no, I would say he's the second president for whom this kind of anti-Islamic language has been used. In Jefferson's times also, when he was running for president, they accused him of being atheist, and they accused him of being an infidel,
right,
which at the time meant not just a bad Christian, but a Muslim. So, right. So Obama could take some, you know, direction from the fact that Jefferson was first assaulted with this kind of language. The only difference, of course, is that then there weren't Muslim citizens who would be offended by using Islam in this negative way. And now, of course, Muslims are rightly appalled by this kind of language because, you know, in the book, I argue that Muslims are included in this country in founding principles, not in spite of their religion, but because of it. And that's a history that might help to end this kind of negative usage of Islam against actual American citizens.
Dr. Spellberg, one more point about your book. It's been also criticized for actually wrongly portraying Jefferson as, you know, benefiting and acquiring knowledge from the Muslim traditions. I wouldn't just call it the Quran, but, you know, Muslim traditions and his Muslim interaction overall. They want you to call this piece of work a story of enlightenment in America, you know, the evolution from one point to the other. What did you say to that?
Well, could you just reframe what the criticism is?
Well, you see, they think that, you know, it's, and I'm just, I was reading some reviews on your book, and one that, mostly very positive, you know, people received it very well, but one which stuck out was about the title, and they think, I mean, the writer actually thought that the mention of the Quran and using the Quran as the context of this evolution of this country was not appropriate in their opinion. And
it's a historical document, mm-hmm. and it's a historical fact that Jefferson bought this Quran to add to his library. And the fact is that he did probably refer to it when thinking about the future of Muslim citizens, but also in his foreign policy, right?
Yes.
So I think these people are criticizing the assumption that the Quran, I mean, I think underlying that criticism is the assumption that the Quran is something that is either not American or threatening to the United States. And of course, I don't see it that way. It's more than a historical artifact. Americans engaged with understanding Islam. Jefferson is representative of that. Even John Adams bought a Quran after he was president. He bought the first American printing of the Quran in Springfield, Massachusetts. So, you know, I don't think that criticism is really warranted. And the book is about more than his Quran, right? It's an attempt to talk about how Americans viewed Islam and Muslims.
Yeah, actually, I found it to be a history of religion in this country and history of Muslims and other minorities. I mean, you mentioned how Catholics were treated, how the Jews were treated in this country in the early days, and, you know, how all these minorities overcame those obstacles and, you know, became so successful in this country.
That's
so it's and rightly so. I mean, a lot of people now call Muslims new kid on the block, so to speak. You know, now they're going through that phase which a lot of other communities and minorities have been through already. You talked about the importance of the Quran in his library.
Yes.
Tell us something about, I mean, in technically speaking, it wasn't just there in his library. It was cataloged in certain order. That's what I read in the book. So can you please say something about that, you know, how it was cataloged and how does it represent the importance of the book in that library?
Sure. I mean, people have talked about the fact that Jefferson created this very elaborate catalog for his books. And some people call it a blueprint of his mind. And he put religion under philosophy, but he also thought that religion could be a branch of law. And so when he put his religious books together, he started with three books on polytheism, on Greek and Roman gods, even Zoroastrianism. And then he put the Quran, and then he put some copies of what Christians call the Old Testament of the Hebrew Bible, and after that, copies of the New Testament and the Old Testament, and then just a bunch of New Testaments and other writings about Christianity.
So the Quran was third on his list, and then came the Bibles.
It was fourth, but, you know, one historian has said, oh, you know, it's somewhere between then paganism and Christianity. But I don't see it that way. I think that Jefferson saw the Quran, even in the end, as a book of law. I think he put it next to the Hebrew Bible or the Old Testament because they're both books of law, right? So it's not a chronological order. And I also think that it's important that he gave it really a place of honor, a place next to revealed religion, and next to the uncompromising monotheism that is both Judaism and Islam.
He also wrote his own Bible, Dr. Spellberg. Jefferson
yes.
also wrote his own Bible, which is called Jefferson's Bible.
Right, but he didn't actually write it. What he did is he took a razor, and he went through the Gospels, and he cut out all the miracles. So he cut out the divinity of Jesus and his resurrection and the virgin birth. Anything that he could not accept by sort of rationally testing it as possible, he cut out. He never shared that with anyone. And God knows he didn't do anything like this to the Quran, right? He doesn't write in the Quran except he signs his initials on one page of the first volume at the bottom, but that's it. There are no notes. With the Bible, he was trying to really make a rationalist tract out of the Gospels. And so he edited them very heavily. And that's what we have is Jefferson's Quran. Sorry, Jefferson's Bible. Yeah, Jefferson's Quran.
You're just giving a plug to your book, I know.
I'm really not trying to do that. Jefferson's Quran represents in sort of writ large our long history of engagement and trying to understand Islam and how there were debates about Islam and Muslims at the founding. Some of these continue. You're right that the anti-Jewish and anti-Catholic rhetoric of the 18th century, it didn't just evaporate, right? Jews and Catholics had to fight for their rights into the 20th century. There's still discrimination against them. But what I try to do is allow a space for Muslims today to see that in America they have roots and they have historical precedents to refer to when they want to assert that they, like everyone else, are citizens with rights.
You have an entire chapter in this book, and a very interesting chapter dealing with the first, Muslim cannot be president of this country. And actually, you quoted certain, events in the history where it was made sure that no religious minority could be president of this country, including Jews, Catholics, pagans, even Hindus were mentioned in those passages.
Exactly.
Yes, of course, that's history. What do you think, moving forward, what's our future? What's Muslims' future in this country?
Well, historians don't do well predicting the future, but I look at the 1788 debate on the ratification of the Constitution. It's important to remember that the Constitution abolished religious tests. And in 1788, even the possibility of a Catholic, a Jew, or a Muslim president had to be admitted as legal and an American precedent, right? So today, in the last chapter, I talk about whether a Muslim could be president. Some people who don't like President Obama think because his father was Muslim that he must be a Muslim, even though President Obama practices Christianity.
They basically quote the Islamic law that, if you're son of a Muslim, then, by Islamic law, you have to be Muslim. But which he's not, obviously.
But he doesn't practice Islam, right? And still we see Islam being used as a criticism of the president and of Keith Ellison and of Andre Carson, our second congressman who happens to be Muslim. And I really think that part of the problem is that Americans don't know much about Islam still. And sometimes what they know is distorted. But I have faith that Americans will do what really was predicted in the 18th century in that debate over who could be a president. And that they will see individuals and their political virtues and their wisdom separate from their religion, and that they will in fact overcome the prejudices they have to choose the best person for the job. And I think there is an open door for Muslims to hold more elected office in this country. We see this at the state level for many people. I think this is a very healthy thing, and I hope that it continues.
Well, Dr. Spellberg, as always, we're running short of time. What an enlightened discussion. This is a great book, excellent account of history of religion in this book, history of minorities, the history of Muslims, and of course about Jefferson, the third president of this country, the author of the Declaration of Independence. I wish we could go on and on, but I appreciate your time. I hope our viewers, those who watch this program on the web or on TV, can have access to this book. This is, of course, available on Amazon.com. But you can also just Google it and read some of the reviews about this book and see what you can learn, not just being here in this country, maybe around the world. Thank you for watching Cafe DC. I'm Faiz Rahman. Goodbye.